I'm rolling. Still rolling.
In the story, the main characters get captured by these agents that work for this fictitious government agency called the ISRP. And because it's a fictitious agency, you know, we're allowed to take some liberties with the way that things are, the way that things look, when thinking about what kind of technology they had. This is really a chance for us to sort of push the sci-fi a little bit. It might be possible that in the underground bunkers where they're actually taking these people, they would probably be using some kind of machines. And so that's where the idea for the androids came. Because they're machines, somebody with psychokinetic abilities wouldn't be able to manipulate their mind or read their mind. So they would send in these robots to work with the people that they had captured or taken in for questioning. I wanted them to feel threatening, but not scary. Knowing that we don't have the budget to do full CG robots, we were gonna have to figure out a way to do this practically. And so when coming up with the design, knowing that it would have to be actors in suits, that sort of helped us structure how these characters would look. And my mind kept coming back around to police officers, law enforcement, and, you know, FBI agents, people that have authority over citizens. They can do whatever they want. They're not necessarily scary, like horrifying and terrifying, but whenever they're around, there's always this kind of unnerving, intimidating factor from a police type of figure. And so that's what we sort of based the design around. I'd sat down with our storyboard artists and we'd come up with ideas for this and different sketches of what they would look like. It ultimately came to sort of a mixture between C-3PO and Captain EO. So it's a robot interior, but it's got this suit because it's an official member of this organization. So they wear uniforms. And then we needed to actually build these helmets practically. We had Will come in and he sculpted them out of clay, cast them in this kind of rubber material, and then he'd create positive molds of it.
I can't believe how exact this looks to the drawing.
Yeah. Wires and tabs and stuff. I thought of even maybe having like some wires shown in here somewhere.
That'd be cool.
He had built each helmet, then he would go in and customize them and put in the lights into the eyes and the magnets so that the helmets would clamp on. And then at the same time, we had two actors that we had hired to play these characters, and so we form fit the suits to them. So we started with just black leather suits, and we actually turned them white by using leather paint. So it's actually white leather paint on these suits. And then had a seamstress and a costume designer come in and custom fit all the latches and everything that was on the suit. The wardrobe was important because for a large part of the film, our main characters are wearing the same costumes throughout the movie.
That was cool because that was the first time that you really got to see, you know, Eric's vision come to life, because you saw, you know, the androids and their custom suits, and I was like, wow, this is actually, you know, because like it's one thing to read it on the page, but then to see it in real life and in the flesh, that was really cool. Just seeing, you know, Ryan in his like Nikes and that like his 80s wardrobe was really cool, and then they put on the overalls on me, which I ended up wearing for like the whole movie for like 2 years, which was interesting.
Yeah, wardrobe was the one thing that kind of threw me a little bit.
Perfect.
Graves, he was a tricky character because when he's first introduced, he's introduced as a journalist. He's supposed to come off as non-threatening to Isaac, but at the same time, he's wearing a bit of a disguise. And I just thought that was so messed up that this guy kind of goes to that length psychologically, that he would dress himself differently, that he would set up this office as sort of like a sting operation.
Yeah, the facial hair, like, we tried to glue some hair on it. It didn't work so well.
I get my pipe, and I'm gonna put together a puzzle today.
We ended up just deciding not to go that route, but the glasses stuck. The kind of sweater vest sort of still went for the sort of professor look.
Okay, when you mix argon with just a household baking soda.
It was just a good way to meet everyone and kind of set the tone of the film.
So pretty early on, the decision was made to shoot on as many real locations as possible, just because our budget didn't allow us to build any sets. Normally, when making a movie, it's like you're shooting partially on location, but partially on a stage in a studio with a built set. But this, we really had to take more of a documentary style and trying to find real locations that would work for the story.
Probably right here or something, and then they could drive off that way or that way.
The entire inside of the ISRP facility, originally when writing the script, the idea there was to build that as a set. But with our budget, very quickly realized that we wouldn't be able to do something like that. So then we would just scout location after location and eventually came upon some underground tunnels in Los Angeles that they used to actually transport criminals back and forth back in the day.
Security breach in Block C, room 284. Repeat, security breach in Block C, room 284. Engage full security lockdown.
So we just embrace these real locations. One of the difficult locations to find was the control room. You know, knowing that we wouldn't be able to build something like this, especially with all the detail that goes into all the switches and panels and buttons and stuff, there was like no way that we could afford to build something like that. So I started looking into real control rooms, looking at a lot of nuclear power plants. And it just so happens around the time that we started searching, a lot of these plants were shutting down and were not allowing access for filming. You know, kind of understandably, if you go into one of these places and you hit the wrong button, it could cause some serious damage. But in a lot of these places, they have training rooms that is a complete replica of a control room. So we were looking for those control rooms to go in and film. But there was just time and time again that we kept getting turned down. And probably about a week before shooting, we had lost our last location that we had booked for that. And a stage popped up that we could have access to. And we found some giant panels as props. And this was kind of a last minute thing. We ended up renting all of these control panels and bringing them into this empty stage and just putting a single light above it. And I remember the night before shooting that, when we were setting it up, it was not looking good. But I think the thing is that when you're looking at it through the camera, there wasn't even a question that it worked.
So the first day of filming, we were in this like really expansive, blank, white studio, because Isaac gets kidnapped, and he wakes up in this like blank room with these two androids next to him.
We were in just a really sterile environment. It was like white walls everywhere, and I think it was on the red lot, which was cool because I'd never been there before.
It was a thrill going on to the red studios to shoot. You know, you walk in and there is this like expanse where you don't know where the floor ends to those walls, and it's very sort of, you know, kind of trippy in your head.
Visually, it was something I'd never seen before, and it was stunning, and I was like, this is a really exciting thing to be part of, and that's kind of when it hit me that what I read on the page would actually be translated on screen as well, which is nice.
That first day was actually really challenging. One, because it's the first day of shooting, you're nervous, you don't know anybody, you're wondering if you're gonna get fired. Just like, it's really scary. But it was also particularly scary because I wasn't working with another actor. Well, I was working with androids, I guess. But I wasn't like talking to another person, and everyone was like probably like 20, 30 feet away from me, and just all watching the monitors, and I felt really pretty exposed and kind of already nervous and afraid, and it was definitely a kind of a scary, challenging day. But I thought like, if I can make it through this day, I can make it through this, because it was pretty scary actually.
But because we've already gone through this process of auditioning and doing the wardrobe test and the screen test, like we already knew each other quite well. So it didn't feel as daunting as sometimes as when you walk onto a new set and everything is just brand new and everyone is really intimidating. But I think the first thing I noticed was that everyone was so nice and just really chill and down to earth, and there was just like this nice, calm energy.
This is gonna be the medium shot, medium two shot.
Medium two shot. Yeah.
Punch!
production, you know, we had to be as resourceful as possible.
That's part of the fun about filmmaking is you get to figure out how to make it work. So a lot of it was, how many cameras are we gonna need? What kind of lighting are we gonna have? And just try to figure out what the look was gonna be, how we were gonna go ahead and accomplish it. Like, grip equipment's like playing with Legos anyway. You gotta figure out how to make something work. I want a camera shot out here, well, let's figure out how to do it, make it work. It becomes something where you have to be innovative about things. You have to actually go out and find a way to do it. But I think Eric and I were pretty, like in film school, we were pretty close on like what we wanted it to look like.
So by shooting in real locations, that was one of the things that helped us get through stuff. We would shoot very quickly. One day, you know, when we were shooting the cabin scene outside of Washington, I think we had 13 pages to shoot that day. So we had two cameras going and we would just run the scene and start shooting. And we just got as much footage as we possibly can. And so I think that's the thing, is that with a production like this, if you can think of it in terms of a documentary, like if you can get the setting, set everything up, you have the script, the actors know what they're gonna say and perform, and then at that point you just let the scene unfold and you just start capturing it and finding the angles, I think that's really a beneficial way to approach something like this.
So we need a dog like this. I remember he skidded into it.
Yeah.
So should we go by him as he's skidding and try to get it?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so if we're on this lens, we'd probably be a little bit further away from him.
Yeah. We're going fast. We're skidding. We're grabbing the gun. Yeah. Okay.
Facility on full security lockdown.
Anything that I had shot before, I would always shot list very meticulously, like down to every 15 minutes I knew what we would be shooting. But with this, I was also a producer on the film, so there's so much stuff in pre-production that there was just literally no time to shot list. And this is the first time that I've gone into something without a shot list. And in some ways you would think it's kind of scary because you know you're at a certain location for a certain amount of time and there's a scene that you have to shoot. Well, not knowing how many shots that you have, how much time you have for each shot can be really challenging. So what I would do is I would just print off the script for that day and I would just highlight the scenes, everything that we needed to shoot. And so I would know, okay, we have three scenes to get through this day and we have 10 hours. So I would kind of break it up that way. But the thing that we actually benefited from was that normally when you have a shot list, you have your shots planned out like very specifically so that you have a certain type of angle. And if you're shooting in a real location, you might set that shot up and realize that it's not really a great angle. And then you start spending all this time trying to light it very specifically because, you know, you have to get this angle, you have to get this shot because it's gonna cut with this shot that you plan next. And then you end up spending a ton of time trying to light stuff. Well, we shot with a lot of natural lighting. So we'd show up and we'd have the natural lighting, this is what the scene looks like, and then we would find the best angles. We'd move the camera around and say, this shot looks great. We know we need to cover this whole shot, let's get a wide, find the best wide angle for this scene. As you're watching things play out, you see the character do something and you go, oh, let's get an insert of that moment. Let's capture that moment so we can emphasize that and it would look great from this angle. And there was a lot of things like that that we ended up being able to find opportunities in not having a plan necessarily and being able to sort of find the scene on the day.
During the abduction scene, we had a 20K light, I'd say 50 feet up in the air, pointed straight down so that it was, you know, cast a strong, powerful light on the actor. 20K light is a massive light and it requires a massive generator to power it. So we had to bring up the generator into a remote location, and we also brought in a genie lift to get the light to height. One of the hardest things about that was that the location was kind of on a slight slope, so that when you brought in the genie lift, the whole thing kind of leaned forward, so you couldn't really push it out too much. But we eventually found a spot where it was level enough to get the light out far enough and high enough into position, and you know, just rigging that whole light was a challenge too. We had to come up with a custom mount, a lot of speed rail, a lot of clamps to position it and secure it safely.
Yeah, it said it's supposed to be cloudy from like 2 to 3 or 2 to 4. We have like a 2-hour window there if it's right.
All right, that's good.
So we did have a few leaf blowers, Tyler and I think it was Eric.
We can do 80. Okay. You can do 80 at 6K, do that. So that's like 4 times the slope.
Yes.
had a few leaf blowers on, just blowing the leaves to create some effect. It's pretty fun.
Start.
Man, every time I hear those trucks trying to turn over, my stomach hurts. We had a yellow truck, and the yellow truck started up just fine, but it was this black truck that just killed us every single time.
So we had to just tow it up eventually, and then once it got up there, I think it still didn't start. So like a lot of the shots that we did were mostly CG with that truck.
Well, we're about to do the truck drop. That should be pretty exciting. Yeah, one of our trucks isn't working, that green one right over there. So we're gonna drop it from a crane and break it.
If the truck landed like this and fell backwards, it would land right here.
Okay.
But it's also possible that it could get into the hood of this one.
That it could hit the hood?
Possibly.
Well, this, still, it'll go all the way up. The
but even boom down, it'll still be probably 6 feet at least.
6 feet what?
From the tailgate to the ground, at least.
6 feet?
Yeah, at least. Like, okay. So when we go up like this, it's gonna pull our truck zone here. And if you don't mind that truck gets destroyed, then we can leave it there.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't have anyone in it because it's just too dangerous.
Okay, so we can have a camera in it.
Yeah, we can have an unmanned camera, no problem.
Okay.
But I wouldn't man it.
Echo, take one.
And action.
In the story, the characters have to take a train through the forest to a character that they're searching for. Normally, you would shoot that on a stage, but we already had 400 visual effects shots as it was. And if you're doing it through green screen, you're gonna have to replace everything outside. You're gonna have to make sure that all the reflections are correct. And it ends up becoming a lot of tedious visual effects work that's not really necessary. And so I was pretty adamant about shooting this for real, on a real train. Originally, we had found a real train up in Northern California, but then some production issues happened, and when we came back to that location, it wasn't going to be available now to shoot. We did find a great location, actually better than our first location, but shooting on a train for real was a very difficult challenge. We only had 6 hours that day from the time that we showed up to the time that we left. When you're working on a train, you know, we only had, I think, like a 3 minute window that we could actually get nonstop recording.
Okay. Ready? We're good to go.
91 Echo.
7134.
So the train would start, we'd call action, we'd go for a while, we'd try to get as much stuff out as possible, and then the train would stop, and then we would have to flip everything around the other way on the train, and then the train would back up in reverse, and then we would continue shooting that way.
Cool, good, thanks for the sound speeds. 91, take two.
And we're rolling.
It was not a lot of time. In fact, at the end of that day, we still hadn't finished everything that we needed to shoot. And so when it came time to do the train scene in the edit, there were some things we had to figure out about how to get the androids off of the train. One of the solutions we came up with was seeing the characters run across the top of the train through the POV of the androids' radar vision.
You can just literally put your foot right here and then just go like this. Green screen over here. Action!
Didn't see that coming.
One more at the same time, the same level, I mean.
You didn't see that coming.
And again.
You didn't see that coming, did you?
So that day was very difficult. But when you do it for real, you get everything for free. Point the camera wherever you want and it's all real. Costa Rica was probably the best part of the physical production. When the characters come out of the facility that they've been imprisoned in, they come out into a place where they have no idea where they are. They don't even speak the language. So having that part take place in Central America was something I knew I wanted to go to the real location, because there wasn't a lot of locations. There was no locations really that you could find that you could fake for Costa Rica that would be either in California or anywhere in the United States. Like, I had searched all over the place. I had never been to Costa Rica, but I had basically scouted the entire location through Google Maps, just looking at all the different places that we needed in the script, and just went around to these places and scouted literally the day before we shot.
I remember when I was talking to Eric about shooting on location, a lot of people were against it, or they thought, you know, you don't have support down there, you don't have anything down there. And I looked at him and I looked at everybody else and basically said, no matter where you point the camera, you're shooting Costa Rica.
By that time, Heidi and Christian and I are really good friends, and just the idea of spending a week with them, you know, in another country was really exciting.
I would say the actors really stepped up and became part of the crew. We had six people total with us, our three main actors, myself, Jason, camera operator, and James, our sound guy. We had to take the camera gear, and we didn't have any lights with us, so we shot with all natural lighting. Anything that we had to carry ourselves. You know, when we got to the treehouse that we shot in had no power. We had to carry all the equipment up ourselves, and it was a pretty decent hike.
You know, we were all really, really hands-on with like carrying equipment up a mountain for like 5 miles, you know.
Equipment going into Costa Rica it's like an additional passenger.
We didn't even have a tripod. We had a shoulder rig, a camera, and I think two lenses.
We literally had a backpack full of gear, and that was primarily it.
Phew!
Why is the camera in a bag?
Camera's in a bag because if it's too cold and we come outside and the nice humidity, it fogs up the lens, the camera, everything. So we have to go ahead and keep it in the bag in order to go ahead and make sure that when we get it out here, it's not so, there's not a lot of condensation in there. So cold out here, it's like taking a shower.
Every time we were down there, no matter what we were doing, we were shooting.
It was scripted, but we didn't know what we were going to run into, so there was no location scout or anything. Like, we were just going into the jungle, and if we saw something cool, we would shoot it.
Eric asked us to go walk up this, like, just pathway up into the rainforest. It's just like Heidi and I just slipping on everything, and it was just funny.
A lot of the stuff that we shot in Costa Rica was guerrilla style. We didn't have permits or anything. We would just, you know, go around and ask for permission to shoot in certain places. And we shot literally the entire time we were there.
Look at the truck, try to read
look
it.
Look at the truck.
Like, one of the locations we can only get to by boat, so we shot while we were on the boat.
He doesn't have to be naturally strong, but he needs to get... He needs to equal Voldemort when he kills him.
Yeah.
Does Harry Potter need to be naturally
strong? Okay. So one night we got into a discussion about Harry Potter and Luke Skywalker.
Oh, yeah, Voldemort, you want to be bad? Let me show you bad.
Yeah.
And I'm going to say...
No, that's boring, because then it's like, all right,
everybody else, no.
When Ryan gets an idea in his head, he can go on for hours, and I was just like, I'm just going to sit there and relax and watch these idiots go at it.
I think really it was a conversation between me and Ryan agreeing with ourselves.
Yes. Being good.
Yes. Yes.
Like, in the end, he should be power enough to overcome evil.
Yes.
I think people really enjoyed it. It was fun, and I think we took advantage of every part of it that we could, and with very, very minimal equipment. So, I have a background in animation and visual effects, and I knew that going into this that we were going to need a lot of visual effects done. Not necessarily the type of visual effects that you would expect, but a lot of the invisible visual effects.
See him phase out of this place in a hurry. Whoop.
He's gone, dude. Things that you may not notice or recognize as a visual effect, but just because we were limiting our production and trying to get a lot of production value out of not having a lot of resources to work with. So I was really leaning heavily on that to sort of heighten or elevate the look of the movie as much as we possibly could. But when we got into post-production, we started logging all the shots that we had to do, and there's a lot of simple shots like screen replacements and stuff, but you start calculating them all up and we ended up with about 400 visual effects shots. And the most that I have ever done on my own was 100 visual effects shots, and that took me 2 years. So the idea was to do a lot of the visual effects myself with a little bit of outside help, but realizing that, you know, 100 visual effects shots could take 2 years, 400 visual effects shots could take 8 years. We were looking at like 5 shots that needed to be completed a day, and there was just absolutely no way that I was going to be able to do it. And at the same time, we couldn't afford to hire a visual effects company to do the visual effects shots that we wanted at the level that we wanted them. So the only option that we had was really to kind of build our own visual effects team full time for a few months just to help get through all the shots. We'd put them up all on the wall so we could see the amount of work that we had, and then every time we finished one, we'd put a piece of green tape over it. So in the story, you actually see the alien creatures. You'd see them for a little bit in the beginning, and then you'd see them for a good amount of time at the end. But they were gonna have to be CG creatures just because the physicality of them, they were much taller than a normal person, but also much skinnier. Trying to pull that off practically would have cost a lot of money for us. So I knew that they were gonna be CG, but didn't really fully know how we were gonna be able to pull it off. That's probably the hardest thing, you know, we've ever had to do, doing a full CG creature like that. Normally when you're shooting a scene like that, you'll have an actor in some sort of gray suit, at least just for reference, but we didn't. We literally filmed everything with nothing there and just added it later on. We shot the scene at the end of the movie where they're at the table. It was literally a C-stand with a stick taped to it with about the correct eye distance, and I'd put a piece of tape on either side, and I just told them, this is where the creature's eyes are gonna be, just use those for reference and stare at those. And I'm just figuring out after the fact how we're gonna put the creature in there. Motion capture was never something that I thought we would be able to do, just from a budget standpoint. I thought that was out of our reach. But animating a creature like that becomes very, very tedious, even if they're not doing much. I knew that, you know, with the time that we had, we still had a deadline. We had to get all these shots done by, so motion capture made the most sense for us just from a time standpoint. And we got very lucky that we had a motion capture stage open up to us that we were able to use for this. So we just went in for one day and did all of the motion capture for the creature.
He's a little big, but that looks cool.
Even in the moments where the creature is just standing still, it's just sitting at the table, we got all of the breathing, all of the subtle head movements, all the little nuances that come with a living being. We picked all of that up in motion capture, and then for the stuff, you know, where the creature's moving around a little bit more, if it's walking, you get all the natural movement automatic and you get it for free. And we came up with a rig where we were able to easily take our motion capture rig and plug it into our 3D rig. Then we went in and animated the face for the parts where it's talking, any facial movement, eye blinking, but all of the major motion from it was captured on a motion capture stage. You know, once you see it all come together and you start seeing it rendered in 3D, and then you start plugging in the motion data to it, and it starts coming to life.
Yeah, you get something that's here, him that's there, and the alien that's right there.
Yep. I can do that.
Yeah, I mean, see what that looks like, but otherwise it looks good.
The initial idea of how in the world are we gonna pull this off, you're kinda just forced into a position where you have to figure it out. Like, it has to get done, you have to figure it out, and then so you do. And that's what we did. And then in about the last 2 months before the movie was delivered, I started working on the shots myself. You know, toward the end, I had to log them and figure out, okay, I can only spend 2 days on this shot. I can only spend 1 day. I have to get 2 of these shots done in 1 day. But you know, it's nice being able to work with a team of people because, you know, everybody's pitching in ideas. Some people are better at certain things than other people.
That's what I thought it was initially, is that you guys were doing like a fake motion blur on it.
Certain ideas that other people would bring to the table, and it was a very collaborative process to get the shots through in the final hour. For the music. you know, I was really going back and forth of whether or not this would be synthesized music or whether it would be orchestra music, like a throwback to the John Carpenter 80s type of score, or if it would be like some John Williams orchestral scores that really have like a cinematic, magical feeling. There's just something about traditional movie music, you know, when you hear it, it's like it just takes you to a whole nother place. It's just a different magical feeling, and so it was pretty apparent that was the direction that we would go. Trying to do all of that in the computer would be a really difficult challenge. I worked with Jermaine on the score for a couple of years. I mean, he had done mock-ups and sort of suites before we had even shot, so I already knew the theme before we shot anything. We kind of had that locked down, but then it was figuring out like what would the rest of the music sound like. And I started looking at old school like 50s invasion movies or monster movies, and a lot of them had this like big brass feeling to them. You know, think about like King Kong or like The Day the Earth Stood Still and War of the Worlds, those type of movies, the music almost feels like it's invading. So we decided to go with a lot of brass, and that was actually the thing that Jermaine decided, was to record a live session of brass instruments. And also, one of the cool things that Jermaine did was he recorded a lot of tuba and then manipulated that sound. And, you know, there's a really great tuba player who, just out of his instrument, can create all sorts of interesting sounds.
So yeah, this is my typical C tuba that I would use in the back row of the orchestra and in a band situation on a big movie soundtrack call. This is what I'm going to use for most of the work that comes up. So that's when you're hearing that upper part. That's my voice going, but I'm droning on another pitch just with the tuba. And I'm not going to do that in most cases in the back row of the orchestra, but it's fun to take it in another direction from time to time. I mean, we spend as tuba players in college or high school or whatever it is, you know, we're training ourselves with this, you know, Western classical music, but these instruments are capable of so much more than just that.
So we went and recorded a bunch of that stuff, and then Jermaine took that and manipulated it and used it in all sorts of interesting ways. Every time you see the androids, I think it's some variation of this like kind of distorted, odd sounding tuba. So it was sort of taking the classical instruments and finding a way to put a sort of supernatural, otherworldly effect to them. And then, you know, he nailed down a lot of the score. A lot of the stuff that he did was just, it sounded great and it was perfect. And then the next step was going and recording it live. And, you know, Jermaine has a lot of experience orchestrating himself, so it was really cool to actually go. We went to Skywalker Sound and recorded a brass section. And it was really cool getting to see Jermaine orchestrate that part of the music. When you hear that stuff live, it's like nothing else. It's really cool to experience. Sort of old school classic sci-fi sound with like a modern day spin by adding in all sorts of odd effects to the live recorded elements. It just brought something really cool, something really new and fresh. That's really the big thing that music does in a movie. It just elevates it.
Stop going. Just went for a little cruise. This is what we always wear.
It looks so beautiful.
Dude, I'm getting slow-mo of this show.
Well, they seem to like this.
Welcome to Sonic. Can I take your order?
I'm rolling. Still rolling. Okay.